Welcome to our Share and Approve webinar. We're going to talk a little bit about using Share and Approve for small and medium companies to manage artwork approvals. And this can be done across multiple stakeholders and different departments. Speaking for us today is going to be Rudy Martinez. He's a solution architect at Esko Brand Solutions. And he brings years of experience in working with the brands on their creative and supply chain challenges. So he has a very holistic approach to packaging design and development. So without further ado, I will hand it over to Rudy.
Thank you very much, Maria. Can you hear me? Is the sound okay?
Yes, we can hear you.
Cool. Thank you so much. Hi, good morning and good afternoon, everybody, wherever you're connected. So indeed, I will have the chance today, the privilege to take you through a discovery of that solution that we call Share and Approve, as well as a little bit of an introduction before we get stuck in. If you have any questions during the webinar, please don't hesitate to actually type them into the questions onto the webinar interface, and then I'm sure that we can go through at the end together with Maria. So without making you wait any longer, I will carry on there. Just before starting, I just wanted to contextualize a little bit. I am very well aware that there are a lot of people that have responded to this webinar coming from various different horizons and various different companies and type of companies. The webinar today is to talk about Share and Approve. Of course, it's one of the tools that we have into our portfolio. Mainly one of the tools around the notions of artwork approval, artwork management, etc. Today it's very much about Share and Approve, which we tend to position for small to medium companies or eventually larger companies which have specific needs, for example, for a specific department or maybe for a specific region, okay? We do have other type of solutions such as Web Center Quick Start or Web Center Base, as we call it. Should you ever need any information about those particular solutions, please drop us an email at hello at esko.com or just register any interest through our website or go through the standard channels that you're used to. That was just a bit about the contextualization. So today it's going to be very much about smaller companies with smaller needs, which I will start talking about right now. In many parts of the world, actually in all parts of the world nowadays, we are seeing for the last 10 years, maybe a bit more even, what we call the phenomenon of SKU proliferation or SKU proliferation. The notion of SKU proliferation comes from the market. It comes from the consumers who are needing more and more products that are individualized to them. If you take the markets, for example, like makeup, there is more and more shades of different lipsticks, for example. Or if you take the market of crisps, you will see that there are more and more flavors. And all of these new specificities or the new SKUs that are creating a problem for the people who have to actually manage artworks within the brand. If on top of that, you are adding the complexity of speed to market and the notion of trying to constantly put products to market faster, because obviously the faster we are and the more relevant to specific trends we are, therefore that notion of trying to go faster to put products to market is very important and will come into the equation. And then something which is becoming apparent and even more and more apparent in the current context is the fact that we have scattered stakeholders. We used to talk about scattered stakeholders, even small to medium company, which would be, for example, scattered all across a country. There are more and more small companies which actually work with employees that will work from home, for example. But it could be that small companies nowadays are also working across different countries or across different departments, et cetera, et cetera. I guess my point here is that the notion of having a file which will basically be into what we used to call a job bag and go from desk to desk into an office, it's kind of something of an old age and it's not happening anymore. So those three things, those three factors, together with the complexity of putting together an artwork to go onto the market, you know, and a label is really complicated. So if you add on top of that the fact that it needs to be fast, there is a lot of them, and together with the scattered collaborators, then it makes the job of people such as the artwork manager really complicated nowadays. And that's why more and more companies need to actually provide or bring implement some tools in order to help those key elements of the being able to put your products to market. They need to help them with the correct tools. So today, what I want to present you is the tool which is called Share and Approve, as I said earlier. It's a very, let's say, simple tool in the way that we like to position it, in the sense that it will answer the need of being able to upload files, share them with various collaborators, view these files either in 2D and 3D, I will come on to those things, review them, annotate those files, and then eventually get them approved either yourself or by different key stakeholders. So this is what I will show you today into this short demonstration. Again, if you have questions, please don't hesitate to type them into the question section, and then I will be very happy to answer them after the demo. But let's see how this works. So Share and Approve. As you can see here, Share and Approve is a web application. So I do not need to install any sort of application on my computer, whether I will be able to access Share and Approve directly from within my web browser. I can work on a Mac, I can work on a PC, I can work with Internet Explorer, Firefox, Google Chrome, or whatever, I'll probably forget one. And the solution will work. This is important because a lot of your collaborators, and especially when you need to actually go or send files for approval, you've got to make sure that the people who will receive these files will actually have the right tools to be able to view those files, review them, comment on them, and be able to eventually approve them. So here with this solution, all it is, it's a web application, which is fully responsive as well, which brings up advantage when it comes to portability. And you will be able then to access it from your own computers. The interface of Share and Approve, well, it's very simple. And again, very easy to adopt for any type of users, but I will come back onto this later. The notion of Share and Approve is that you will have either folders or files, and inside those folders or those files, or sorry, attached to these folders or those files, you'll be able to actually take certain actions onto them. So let's see this particular file here, which I have, which is called Get Set Bottle Green. It's a PDF. I can see that the approval status of this file is actually pending. I can see the size of that file, who created it, which here in this case, it's myself, when I did it. And then it has some information, for example, as who did I share this file with. We can also take some action onto this file, such as getting more details, downloading the file, deleting it if I have the right to actually delete it, because there's a sort of the whole notion of user management within the solution. I will also be able to share it with various different people based on some options that I can choose. And then I will also be able to edit it or upversion this file. Okay, but what I suggest is before doing any of these things, which are pretty basic, what I suggest is to actually take a file, and then we will pretend that we are an artwork manager. We've just been working, for example, with an agency onto a new artwork which has been created, and then we will take that file and then route it for approval to certain of my collaborators, which will need to approve it. So I will take, which file do I want to take on this particular one? I will take my orange file, and I will simply take it from a folder and drop it into the window. As you can see, when I drop my file onto the window, there's a status bar here. And then after a few seconds, my file will appear directly into my interface. Okay. Once the file is appearing into my interface, I can now actually view it within what we will call the viewer. By the way, I must apologize. I could go full screen here to make it more comfortable for you to see. So if I click onto my file here, I will have access to my file in full resolution. Again, any of your collaborators with whom you would have shared this file will not need any third-party application. You don't need to have Illustrator, you don't need to have Photoshop, you don't need to have things such as Acrobat Reader or anything. You will be able to open any kind of graphic files, including Illustrator and Photoshop and whatever format you might need, directly into that viewer. You will have access to various different options here, which I will come back to in a second. I just want to show you some other notions before getting back to some of the options and some of the how you can actually annotate and review this file. So I have now uploaded my file, and what I would like to do is to set up an approval process so that I can actually share it with my colleagues and request for them to take action to review my file. How do I do this? So I simply click on this button, and then I have several options. I will have the option to do a single stage approval. So for example, I could select someone, one of my collaborators. For example, here, I'm going to select myself. Therefore, it makes it simple. And then I will send me a message, and I will say, hi, Rudy. I'm not mad talking to myself, but this is the new file for the orange campaign. Would you please review it and pay special attention to the die line? I believe the printer may have provided the wrong one, or something like this, you know, and it could be. You can also select a due date, and then you can start your approval cycle. What it means is that in parallel, or at the same time, the system will send an email to that person, and that person will actually receive a notification. Let me see if I can, I didn't prepare for that, but let me just check if I can see into my email there. Got to wait for a few seconds until it appears into my email. Right here. Okay. There, sorry, it's now appeared. And basically, I receive an email which looks like this, with a thumbnail of my file, with a message from my colleague. And what I can do is I can simply click on View the Document, and it will take me through the interface so that I can actually review my file and eventually put some annotations onto it, approve or reject it. Now, let's say where this might be very useful is if you have collaborators who are not used to receive those kind of notifications, et cetera. I'm thinking of collaborators such as, let's say, people who work in regulatory, or maybe a lawyer that needs to review some of the information onto your file. Realistically, they do not want to have to connect to an interface or something like this. All they want to do is to be able to do what I've just done here, which is click onto a link into an email, end up into the right location, therefore into the file directly, use some very simple tools. I don't know, for example, they could go at the back of this file here, and they would say, well, here, this is a spelling mistake. Would you please correct? Or something like this, you know. And your collaborators, again, will be able to make all these kind of comments. I will come back onto the type of comments, but for example, this person could then decide to reject the file. And once the file has been rejected, then of course, on your dashboard, you will be notified. Let me just go here in order to show you. You will be notified that this file has got a rejected status. There you go. Rejected status here. Something I forgot to mention is obviously there are different ways to actually display files onto the screen. I personally like this view when I have a list and I can see all the details onto my view here. Some people will be more comfortable with a view like this, which might be a bit more graphic, let's say. But personally, I do like this view. So if you don't mind, that we'll carry on with that one. So what else could we do here? Of course, on this particular file that I've just uploaded, I decided to go with what we call a simple approval cycle. It's very simple. I've just decided to send it to a colleague for that colleague to approve it. It's never that simple. And obviously, what you need to do with a file, often in your cases, even if you're a small company, even if you don't have that many number of stakeholders or collaborators, you might want to set up what we call a complex approval cycle. So let me just do this very quickly. I will take another file here, the one which is called Blue. I will drop it into my interface. By the way, I could upload several files at the same time. I've just decided to upload one here, but I could show you this a little bit later. So here I've uploaded my blue file, as you can see. And this time when I say setup approval, instead of selecting a single stage approval, what I would like to do is an advanced approval setup. So this is what I'm going to do here. It will take me to that smaller interface, to that little interface here. And then here I'm going to be able to define what are the stages of approval, which I could say. For example, once the file has arrived, I could say that I would like marketing approval. So I would say this is my marketing stage, and then I would like Rudy. Sorry, I'm just kind of a jack of all trades here. Rudy is going to approve on behalf of marketing. So maybe the marketeer will have to check things such as the color, such as the fonts, such as are the brand guidelines really well respected? And then maybe some of the text as well. I don't know if it's the right range, if it's the right claims, et cetera, et cetera. Maybe we might also want to have a packaging approval where we're going to have someone from the technical department, which again would need to approve the technical drawings, if the bleeds have been respected, and maybe even if the barcode is actually correct. And again, we could select someone else from the list of our users. In the case of a demo, I like to send everything to me, is just so that my colleagues don't get confused by receiving random files to approve. And then again, we could add several stages like this, but I think you understand the purpose of what I'm doing. When we do this, obviously, those stages can be created either sequential or parallel, or sequential plus parallel. You know, there are many different options that you can create. Again, this is a very quick demo today and a quick discovery, so I don't want to go into too much details. But should you want more information about these kind of features in the future, I'm sure we can organize some demos specific to you and your businesses, and we can go through those things. In this case, I don't want to make it too complex for myself. I don't want to drag you through too many approvals, so I will just make a marketing approval, start this. And then as my approval has started, then obviously, since I've sent it to me, then I will have the opportunity to review my file. So what we're going to do here is I'm going to take you through some of the different functionalities that we have in the viewer. And then in order to show you, you know, what the array of possibilities that you have. So let's say, I'm not going to take you through some of our navigation buttons here, but some of the things that might be useful for you guys might be to be able to rotate the file. This is a very simple thing to do, but in the olden days where we didn't have those kind of functionalities, you might have had to break your neck in order to look at the files all around, or it might be useful when you're working on packaging with several flaps, etc., where you might want to actually rotate your file in order to read some ingredient lists easier, for example. It doesn't touch the integrity of the file, it is just the way that you view it. Same thing with the flip here. This might more be useful when you, for example, you've printed on the transparent film and you would need to approve a file which is actually printed the in symmetry. Other tools such as a ruler with different ways to measure distances. For example, we can measure the distance here of this particular label. I can see that. I'm sorry, I'm based in Europe and I work in millimeters, but it would also work with the imperial system if you needed to. And again, based on to that information which I just gathered here, which was my dimension of 205 millimeter, what I could do is I could capture that information and say, oops, no, actually it wouldn't be oops, but it would say, hi John, no, not hi John, let's not have a conversation. We would say, please increase the size of this label by or to 150 millimeter, okay. So that's, for example, what you can do with measures. You could also measure things such as, well, the color density into a specific area of your artwork. So here I'm measuring what colors do I have here. I can see that my Pantone 299 is used at 100% and my Pantone 2925 is used at 80% with a total inkage of 180%. Again, do I want to make an annotation out of this? Do I not want? This is up to you. And what you would like to do according to your particular project. So I'm just going to keep this, and then I'm going to say that I want to make an annotation out of this. For example, it will be, please change the Pantone colors. And apologize if I make spelling mistakes when I'm typing. I'm not very good at speaking and typing at the same time. other kind of tools which might be useful. If you work in the pharma industry, you can actually check Braille here. If you work into any industries, you might want to scan your barcode, make sure that they can actually read properly. And then again, I can see it here. I can see that it's been actually applied onto the right layer, the black layer. But maybe I'm just realizing here that the reading I get on my barcode is giving me the wrong barcode. So this is the wrong barcode. Would you please change it to, and then we'll give a new number for a barcode. Again, I'll be able to do all these kind of changes. There are many other options and many other things that you can do in the system. I know that I tend to speak a lot, and I'm just mindful of the time. So I will actually skim through some of those in order to make it simple. You have other tools such as Calipus here, or some of my preferred tools here, which are about being able to detect certain specific text within your artwork, as long as it hasn't been vectorized. For example, here I could try to highlight where in my artwork I would find the notion of carbohydrate, if I can spell carbohydrate myself, yes. And as you can see here, the software has been able to highlight where carbohydrate can be found onto my artwork. So again, it might be useful for the people who are responsible for list of ingredients, etc., etc. Out of these kind of tools, you can also use this, which again, it might be very useful. If I want to search a specific minimum font size, I will be able to set that font size here and then to tell my software, please highlight all of the text which has a specific, which is less than a certain font size. Once I have found that text, again, I can actually make an annotation out to this and say, well, following EU rules, please make sure this font is minimum 6 points, for example. And then I'll be able to save this as an annotation. Again, I can do also, because I'm showing you all sorts of very specific annotations here, but you could also have standard type of annotations. For example, here I have my normal pen, and I will be able to circle that area, for example, and say, this is not the right fruit. Please amend, for example, or I could also post very simple post-its and put some any kind of information here. Okay, these are for the type of annotations that you can do. There are other very useful features onto this this viewer. One of my favorite, for example, is to be able to actually see all of my channels, all of the channels that have been created. This might be more useful for the technical departments, for example. So, for example, I could say, well, I just want to see my white layer, you know, because that actual artwork is being printed on a transparent film or something nice. So I want to make sure that the white has been set up correctly by my agency. Or I would like to see only my silver foil here, which I can see there. Or what I would like to do is to enable all of my layers and see a full color separation of all of my different channels onto my artwork, you know, and you will be able to do this. For someone who's worked in the brands, you know, and in this industry for 15 to 20 years, I used to pay a fortune for my agencies to actually do that color separation for me in the past. So I don't want to dwell too much onto this, but let's say that this particular artwork here that we've decided, there are way too many changes. So what we'll decide to do is to reject it, okay? When you reject this artwork, you can actually give a reason why you have rejected it. And then it will appear into my list of files, as a rejected document, as we can see it here. So what kind of choice do I have? Well, maybe I will ask my agency to review this file by being able to share it with them. And then when they will actually make the changes onto this file, they will have the opportunity to upload a new version. So let's do this right now. File for webinar. We will upload the second file. And then what will happen here is, as you can see in a second, once the file is finished uploaded, we will have now this file, which has been updated as version 2. This is very important because the file keeps the same name. It's version 2. And that brings us to the notion of version control into the system. In To Share and Approve, you will have full version control onto your system. It means that it's finished the olden days where people would approve a file, but will receive it by email and they wouldn't even be sure that this is the latest version, et cetera, et cetera. Here in Share and Approve, you will be able to actually have the entire history of your files, as well as the entire control over your different versions, okay? So now that this file has been uploaded, the new file has been uploaded, what I can do is I can actually re-trigger my approval cycle, which was previously started. So I will start that approval cycle. And then once I'm going back as the marketeer to see if my changes have been made, then what I will be able to do is instead of actually going through the whole artwork again, what I will be able to do is to click on that little button there, which will allow me to compare versions. And what I want to do here is I want to compare my version one, which was my reference version, together with my current version. And because I'm a lazy person, really, you know, what I like to do is to ask the software to do it for me. So if I click onto that little icon here, then the software will actually automatically give me a third view where I will be able to see highlighted for me there the differences between the two artworks which I have produced. So let's see what they are. I can see here that there's a big change, you know, and indeed what it means is that the barcode has been highlighted. And indeed, if I was to zoom out a little bit, we can see that this barcode here was finishes by 31, this one finishes by 22. What it means is that the system will actually compare your two files and being able to highlight the differences. One which might be a bit more tricky to spot is that one at the back. I can see that something has changed. So by zooming in, I can actually go into my file and I can see that indeed in the current new version, electrolyte is actually spelled correctly, where before it was spelled electrolyte. So I was missing an R. By making that change, it's actually changed the entire layout of my text, and therefore it shows me that kind of change here. I can also see that there's been a few other things changed. For example, zinc was written in italic, and thin, and now it's actually written straight and bold, hence why there is also that change there. So that's the sort of things that the software will be able to spot for you, meaning that instead of having actually spending the whole time to review my artwork again, and I'm sure you have collaborators who get frustrated when they have to get to approve the same thing and then again and again and again, this time they will be able to save an immense amount of time and be able to now review those files, make sure that, for example, they can actually see their previous annotations. So let's see, I would like to see the annotations from my reference document, and I would like to go through them one by one. Okay, these were my annotations. I can now make sure that everything I had instructed has been done, and therefore, as I'm safe, I can actually approve my file. The system here, as you see, will not allow me to approve my file. Why? This is a security. This is just to make sure that you need to be into the current view of your project, of your file, sorry, in order to be able to approve a file. This is a security, which again, it will allow you to avoid making mistakes. So I now approve my file, I have this right, and my file is approved, okay? So this was very much of a very, very quick notion and a very, very quick demo in order to show you how Share and Approve will allow you to upload a file, send it for approval, either a simple or a complex approval, then get people to review this file, eventually compare different versions and basically control your approval process. Something I forgot to show you yet is to actually go into that file. So let's see, now we'll go into the information about this file. And as I said, I can see that this file is version 2, so I can have control on my version, and I can see the history of this file. When was version 1 uploaded, when it was rejected, etc., etc. So this, as well as the annotations on the file, will always stay with this file, meaning that you will have entire guarantee to get that audit trail, which might be very useful for you in the future. For example, if your printer has printed the wrong file, or if there is a dispute onto one stakeholder having approved certain things, then you'll be able to refer to the history of the file. Again, I'm mindful of the time, and I want to give you enough time for questions at the end, but there are a few notions which I would like to talk to you about before finishing. Obviously, here you've seen me just uploading files randomly into the system. You can do this. What you can do is you can also create folders in order to drop certain file. For example, here I've created a folder which I've called EMEA Launch, and I've decided to have various different files for one of my campaigns. It gives me the opportunity to then eventually set up approvals onto these files or approve them myself, and also talk to you about another notion, which is the type of files that you'll be able to use within the system. There are no restrictions, for example, on the size of the file or on the format of the file. So again, finish the days where you are limited by your 10 megabyte email inbox in order to share files with your colleagues. You don't need to worry about those things anymore. If the file is bigger than 10 megabytes, if it's bigger than 100 megabytes, you will still be able to see it. Same thing, this is a Photoshop file, and how many people have been struggling with Photoshop files? They had to install Photoshop. Their IT wouldn't let them have Photoshop because it's an expensive tool. Here you can actually see this file directly into the viewer, and eventually, if there are any specific channels onto that file, they will be able to actually separate them here. It's not very relevant there because this image is actually a CMYK image, but again, it's just to illustrate the principle here. These are very much flat, static files, and again, you see illustrations and stuff like this, but what I could show you as well is things such as 3D files. So we have that great feature which will allow you to, for example, show packaging into 3D and being able to approve and comment onto 3D files. That feature was created because we are well aware at Esko that packaging isn't a flat world. You live into the world of retail, in the world of package, which is in 3D. So we have enabled those functionalities where you're able to upload 3D files and then review them, comment them, annotate them, et cetera, which would again make life simpler for people who are not necessarily at ease with structural design or who are not capable necessarily to know how a specific packaging will fold, for example. So that's one of the notions I wanted to talk to you about. What you can do is you can also create yourself some folders. For example, here I created myself a folder with all of my die lines, or another folder with all of my 3D render. Let's go into the die line because it allows me to tell you another notion of the system. We talk a lot about artwork approval and artwork review, but of course there are a whole array of type of files and or type of files or assets that you may want to review within your company. We often talk about packaging artwork, but it could be other type of artwork, for example, any form of communication, brochures, leaflets, etc., etc. But it could also be your structural design files or your die lines. So here, for example, I have some die lines here that I can see based on to the type of file. Share and approve is able to recognize these files, and here it's able to actually show me the right layers, and it will tell me, well, here in this particular case, I'm able to separate my layers. And because this is a file which has a certain intelligence built into it, I should be, in theory, I hope that works, yes, of course, I'm able to also display the 3D file which goes together with it. The way that works is that Share and Approve is able to identify that this here, the red lines are actually a crease line and the black lines are actually a cut line, and therefore it's able to fold them all at 90 degrees and show me that box into 3D. So again, if you have people that work into your company onto maybe the packaging technologists, and their complexity is to get their die lines approved or reviewed when they come back from the printer or from their converters, that's the sort of things that you will be able to do with the system. Okay. One last thing I wanted to show you, just because it's a cool and a fun things to see, is the way that we support 3D. I showed you with an example earlier. I'll show you with another example here. So you're able to upload those 3D files depending on how big they are. They might display a bit faster or slower, but this one is a few tens of megs, and it's displaying quite fast. I'm able to actually see my file here. I'm able to actually move it, rotate it, even change the lighting around my file, as you can see. And then eventually, as I said earlier, you could even make annotations and review this file, send it for approval. So this was for a quick overview of the software. I would like to get back very quickly onto the presentation, if you don't mind, before finishing. And when we are here, I would like to just recap on the benefits of the software, which I've listed this morning when I prepared. The benefits are very evident. The notion of freedom, which I personally like, is that notion that you will be able to work with all files of all size, unlike the restrictions that you had with emails, and you do not need to have any tools, any third-party tool installed onto your computer. The notion of speed, into some of the testimonials that we've had and the research that we've done, we know that on average, in minimum, it will increase your speed in reviewing files by times three, you know, compared to not having any tools to do it. I have seen customers where it would actually increase by a lot more than times three. The quality, of course, because you will have accuracy on what people will actually annotate, what they will be able to review, and that eventually will lead to a lesser number of reprints or product recall, which would cost eventually money to your company, so you would be able to avoid those. Traceability, because of course that system being a central system where all of your users will be able to connect and to collaborate with, it can become your single source of truth, where you'll be able to have, as I showed you earlier, version control and audit trail. So this is very important. Remote working, and especially into the times that we're living now, we are seeing more and more companies and more small and medium companies as well, where people are actually working from home, etc. And it's very important to be able to enable those people to still work and still put products onto the market. User adoption, I think that's one of the keys. It takes about 15 minutes to get the hand of a hold of the system and to really understand how to use it. After an hour, you become what we call a master user. So the user adoption is extremely key here, in the sense that you don't really need training in order to know how to use that. And I think that in order to bring all of your stakeholders on board when you implement that solution, it's very, very important. And then, as we mentioned earlier, it's a step into artwork management. So if your company is planning on growing, if you're launching more and more products, this share and approve might be the right product for you. But then obviously, as I mentioned earlier, we have other type of products within Esko, you know, which will allow you to do things in an even more, let's say, managed way. And so we have the opportunity to eventually discuss with you on the right fit, whether or not it's share and approve, the product that we call Quick Start or a full-blown web center. That was for me. I'm going to open the floor to questions. Before I do so, should you have any inquiries about the software or about the solution or about any of our other products, please do drop an email to hello@esko.com, and I'm sure that our my colleagues will be very happy to help you and even put us in touch if we need to discuss further your needs. Can I leave it to you, Maria, for the questions?
Yes, thank you so much, Rudy. We do have quite a few questions that have come in, so we'll go ahead and get started. The first one, is it possible to download the file that is routed with the annotations?
No, the annotations are embedded into the system, and the idea is that we want to control the version of the truth and everything which is happening. If we actually start to take the files outside the system, then people might be able to do things, annotate them, etc., outside the system, and we will lose actually the single source of truth. So it's important that everything goes through the system.
Mm-hmm. Can you preset different advanced approval workflows?
Absolutely. Yes, you can actually preset them so that whenever you have a file, you can just use that preset, and then it will actually always follow the same complex approval workflow. Yeah.
Great. The next question is, how can I verify the text? For example, can I apply a Word file?
Not in this solution. So this is one of the great examples, you know, where, for example, when you need advanced compare solutions with text or things like this, we have other solutions which are covered within our solution called Web Center. So again, this is typically the kind of a case study where it would be great to receive an email from you, discuss your specific case, and then tell you which software would be the best match for you.
Okay, great. What about ownership of the designs? Where are the files stored after uploading?
So the files are stored in the cloud. If you want to know, it's actually on Amazon Cloud. You know, the files are actually your files. They're not Esko files, or they're not anyone. You know, and they are actually hosted there for you. So we, how do we call this? We manage the service for you, of course, and we take responsibility for this, for the backup, etc. But these are your files. They don't. They have nothing to do with Esko.
And what other comparison modes are available besides current file, previous file, differences between the files?
Sorry, can you repeat? I didn't hear this one.
What other comparison modes are available besides current file, previous file, difference between files?
I see. So you can compare anything with anything, really, in the system. You can compare, obviously, various different versions. This is the example which is the most common. But for example, you could compare two files with each other, two very different files with each other. Obviously, eventually, if you need to use that tool, you might use it for in order to check that the layout is consistent across a range. So you'll be able to compare those files, put them side by side on the screen. I've only shown you this, the functionality where you're actually highlighting typically two the differences. But one of the cases, for example, is you have your mechanical file which has been approved, and you would like then to approve it against, to compare it with your approval PDF, which has been sent by your printer. Therefore, you'll be able to actually put the files together. And then eventually, what your printer might have done is they changed the layout, or they have changed the die line on this. So you will be able to use the tool in order to realign them automatically or manually, and then compare those versions, for example. So there are multiple ways. You could even compare an Illustrator file with a PDF file. You could compare 3D files together, et cetera, et cetera. There are possibilities are endless in terms of what you can compare. Anything which is in the system can be compared with another thing.
Great. The next question is, how or can I compare a new PDF with an existing file I have in my PC so it's not currently part of the workflow?
Yes, I mean, in the sense that you will be able to do just like I did in the demo. You'll be able to take that file which is on your computer, upload it onto the system, and then you'll be able to compare them yourself directly on them. You don't need to necessarily route it for approval. You can just drop a file like this in there, select it, or select a couple of files, and then compare them together.
Okay, and can you copy an approval set up to another file, or is there a kind of template you can reuse again and again?
Can you repeat? Sorry, I didn't understand this one.
Can you copy an approval set up to another file?
Yeah, I think that's in relation to the first question that was asked. What you do is you don't actually copy the approval from one file to the other. What you will do is you'll actually set up yourself a specific approval cycle, and then you'll be able to reuse that template if you want onto any file that you would like. Actually, I forgot to mention something in the during the presentation. We do offer trial of the software. So if you have questions like this and you would like to actually be able to test all these functionalities by yourself, if you drop an email to my colleague on hello@esko.com, they will be able to discuss with you on the need and to get you access to a trial version of the system.
Okay.
Sorry, Maria, I thought it was worth mentioning because I have lots of technical questions and I'm thinking that it might be worth for people to be able to try it for themselves.
Yeah, absolutely. And if anyone wants to try it out, you can email hello@esko.com and we can get you set up with a trial. We still have a few more questions. So seeing that it can read multiple format files, do I need to create PDF files anymore? So I used to create PDF files from Illustrator in order to get approvals.
Not necessarily. This is up to you, basically. Personally, I'm a fan of the PDF format. So on a personal level, I always like it. But what you could do is you could send directly an Illustrator file or a Photoshop file. You could even send a JPEG file if you wanted. And you will have the assurance that the person who will actually see the file will see the same thing as you do. And I think this is the key. This is the reason why we use PDF. But if you want to do it with an Illustrator file, for example, it's absolutely okay.
Great. And so if the artwork is converted to outlines, is it still possible to check the minimum font size?
No. No, this is the limitation, obviously. You know, you need to have an artwork which hasn't been outlined, you know. Again, if it's a PDF format, it shouldn't be a problem. And you should be able to work this way. I know why people do outline artwork, fonts, but theoretically, in this particular case, you don't need to do it anymore once you have the right tools. The problem is when you don't have tools, you need to do that because what you want to make sure is that when the people who will approve this file or review it or use it, you want to make sure that they will not open it and that the font will actually be changed. Where here, because you have the security that whatever you send is going to be displayed correctly, then you can actually leave the font without outlining them within the system. Within your system, sorry. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and is there an audit trail?
Yes, I don't know if you've missed it, but I showed you, for example, what was the audit trail. So obviously I had only two versions, so the audit trail was pretty minimum, but you will see absolutely everything which is happening to your files, who has approved them, when they were approved, who has rejected, how many versions, what happened to each of the versions. And then obviously in every version that you have, you will keep the history as well of all the annotations that have been made by whom and when.
Great. And then can you change a single ingredient across many files?
As in changing the artwork automatically? I guess that would be the question. This is not a functionality that Share and Approve allows, but this is a functionality which we would be very keen to talk to you about for WebCenter, because indeed, into the release of our latest opus of WebCenter, those kind of simple changes will be something that we're implementing in order to help brands being able to do automated changes onto their artwork. It's a whole big new topic. Definitely not onto the positioning of Share and Approve, but if you have those kind of specific requirements, our product team would be very happy to discuss with you and help you with that kind of project.
All right. And then for when there are multiple stakeholders, how does the approval process work when I have a mixture of approvals and rejections from multiple people in one version?
Yeah, so this will be depending on the way that you set up your approval. I showed you a very quick way to do it. What I suggest is that we do a trial and we do a demo where I can show you exactly the way it works. But basically, you can set up specific rules, whether you would like the approval to restart from the beginning and go back through all of your stakeholders, or if it would need to go through specific stakeholders, etc., etc. These are into the more granular settings that you can do and that you can apply to the system.
Great. And then
I've never heard so many questions.
I know.
Webinar, it's great.
Keep them coming. So can you export the audit trails for each file?
No. So again, Share and Approve is an entry-level software. The ability to export audit trail or to export reports and things like this are enabled within WebCenter, for example. With it, Share and Approve, everything stays inherent to the system.
Okay. And then would this be considered a validatable system for medical device companies?
You know, this is where the limits of my knowledge stops. Purely because when it comes to validation, I'm actually not the best person to talk to. So what I suggest is drop us an email and then I will ask the question. Or Maria, maybe we can take that question and answer to the person who asked it directly. Because to be fair, I don't have the answer to this question myself.
Yeah, for sure. We can look into it and follow up. Okay, it looks like we have one more question. Who is able to see the files? Anyone invited to give approval, or can more people see them?
This is down to right management. So who you will give the rights to within your system, depending on what rights people have to a certain folder, or which group those people belong to. That's how we say it, et cetera, et cetera. So we have a whole system of having the user right management, and this is how we will actually restrict the certain access and certain visibility to the files that you choose and the folders that you choose.
Okay, great. I think that we have made it through all of the questions.
Wow.
Yeah. Great job, everyone. Those are a lot of really great questions. Again, if you want to look at a free trial, you can email hello@esko.com and we can help get you set up. Otherwise, all the registrants for this webinar will be sent the recording afterwards as soon as it's available. And we'll have more information for how you can follow up when we send out that recording. And as I was saying that, we have one more question that came in. Can the stages include more than one person?
Yes, of course. Yes, sorry. The stages can be done either by people or by group or by role. So there are different ways to actually set them up. So yes, indeed, they can include more than one person. Yes.
Okay.
Thank you very much for those questions. They were very good. I'm impressed. Some of them made me trip. So thanks very much for your time today. And I hope to hear about you very soon.
All right, great. You can all expect the recording shortly. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.